I thought we'd move ahead. I hope it's not rude while you're eating, but I wanted to respect your time and be sure that we move forward. And let's see, we wanted to... Do we want to do anything? Yeah, we want to thank the great and general, good General Court. Thank you so much for all you've done for us. That's you, Michael, and others, you know? Thank you very much. Really appreciate all you've done. There's never been an occasion where I haven't called for support where someone said, no, that's a terrible idea, okay? And they've been right behind us every step of the way. And it works with us supporting your constituents, and we're very glad to do that. Well, I want to move forward with the agenda. It's not going to take as long as it looks, I guess, but I did want to provide the you with some budget information. And and the first thing, and really this is all good news that we have. I don't know how you feel about it, but the governor's budget is something that's very exciting for us. It provides $20 million just for community colleges. It provides $20 million for the community college, the 15 community colleges. And I think that this is a watershed moment for BCC. It's an inflective moment for the Commonwealth and for public higher education. We have been poor children of the Commonwealth, despite serving all of the students that we serve. And the governor has really put himself forward. I'm sure you'll agree, whether you agree with the budget proposal or not. This is a bold, courageous step from the governor. And it's the first time, Commissioner Freeland, by the way, said he's been 40 years in Massachusetts and has never seen a governor come forward for public higher education the way this governor has. So, as I mentioned, this is an inflective moment. It calls for increases of $112 million more to the Mass Grant. If you don't know the Mass Grant program, that's direct scholarship aid for our students. And it's something that we badly need in this time, as always. And it's based, $20 million, I'll talk a little bit later about the $20 million distribution among the 15 community colleges and how it will be distributed. There's also a goal that the governor has to work toward a goal, can't make it in 1 year, but to work toward a goal of at least 50% state support for public higher education. Just to give you an indication, I'm sure you already know this, back in the old days, in the 70s or so, state support for public higher education was up to the 80-90% range. 80-90-75-85-90% range. And that was supposedly a inviolable compact between the state and public higher education. Well, as you know, what's happened as life happens and stuff happens and the budget became what it is over the years. So we're down now, we at Bristol are down now to I think just a shade under 30%, 30%. But I'm not whining about that. I mean, it is what it is, and you have done the best you could with the scarce resources that have been made available to you. So the $20 million is a, as I mentioned, it's an inflective moment for us. It's really a watershed, and it will enable us to do. We've been able to do great things with that 30% funding across the Bristol County. But we want to continue, and this is like I always use the term as a former pilot of a JATO takeoff, jet assisted takeoff. This really gives us a shot and a boost to move forward to new levels of achievement and service for your constituents, our students. I wanted to mention also that apart from that 50% goal, that there will be increases in the Vision Project incentive grant. that is controlled by the Department of Higher Education and awarded on the basis of performance and proposals to complement and support and bolster the goals of the Vision Project. For Bristol Community College, it means more if we get this, okay? And I'll get into this a little bit later, but it means much more full-time faculty positions, many more, and it means instructional support services. We need advisors, we need financial aid counselors. We need, as we unfortunately have seen in the country, we need personal counseling as well for people that need some psychological help. We can't do it all, but we can provide some help. So those are things that we have in mind, and they complement our two most important goals here at the college. Most important goal is student success, but our two most important priorities, instructional support. Everything needs to go to support the students in the classroom. And full-time faculty is a good example of that. In the years that I've been here, we've gone from 99 full-time faculty to 135 full-time faculty, and that's with, and you know what the economic situation has been over these last 10, 12, 13 years. So I'm very proud that we've been able to do that, and that's our most important product. College is only as good as its faculty, and we have an outstanding faculty, and we want to add to the bolster the ranks of our full-time faculty. In addition, instructional support, we need to get that support services, get those support services out to our students. Before I continue, I was remiss. I wanted to move forward with some introductions, okay? And if I could, in alphabetical order, I wanted to start with, if you just raise your hand, if you would, Professor Catherine Adamowicz, Vice President of the Faculty Union Chapter, Professional Staff Chapter. Jason Almeida, our Student Trustee. We have Ann Brum, New Bedford Student Senate. Kathy Burns is here, our Director of Student Life. Antonio Cabral, Representative. There he is. Thank you, Tony, for coming. Nick Clemens from Congressman Kennedy's office. There's Nick. Pam Colinari. Pamela is our Alumni Association President. Joanne Field, Student Senator. Joanne, there she is. You've met Fernando Garcia, the shy and retiring Chair of our Board of Trustees. Attorney Jim Grady, current trustee, former Chair of the Trustees. Gene Grandchamp, Faculty and Professional Staff Senate Secretary. Patricia Haddad, representative. There she is, we got it with her mouth full. How about a few words? You're gonna hear from Alti Hickey, our AFSCME officer and steward, there he is. Stephanie Houghton from Elizabeth Warren's office, Senator Warren, there's Stephanie. Let's see, we have Representative Steve Howitt is here. There he is, yep. Melanie Johnson, another AFSCME officer. Mohammed Conti, who you'll hear from later as a speaker. Congressman William Keating, Congressman Keating, thank you so much for coming. Deborah Kenny, member of our Board of Trustees. Now here's an interesting reintroduction, Janet Lavelle. She has a few more hours representing Senator Kerry's office. I think noontime the position expires or something. I'm not sure what happened. Not you. But Jenna's been a wonderful supporter of BCC and attending in for Senator Kerry. Representative Chris Markey is here from our House of Representatives. Aaron Martle, the Student Senate Vice President. Susan McCord, Professor McCord, President of our Faculty and Students Professional Staff Senate. Douglas Mendes, Student Senator. We have Mike Murray from Senator Montigny's office. Mike. And we have Nicole Thibault from Representative Shauna O'Connell's office. There's Nicole. Kiko Oro from our House of Representatives. Thank you. Daughter just graduated last year and now transferred. I'll be talking about transferability, and her daughter's a living example at UMass Dartmouth. That's the way to run these things. Tobias Paulo, there he is, from Representative Cazero's office. Elizabeth Poirier from Attleboro and the House of Representatives. There we go. Thank you for coming. Senator Michael Rodericks. Senator, there he is right in front of us. Jason Said, Senate, Student Senate President. There he is. Paul Schmidt, Representative Paul Schmidt. Yes, thank you. And the first, his first legislative breakfast, Representative Alan Sylvia. Alan, yeah, brand new. Board of Trustees member, Diane Sylvia, alumni representative. David Sullivan, Representative David Sullivan. There he is. Ashley Tillman, student. There she is. And Dr. Ronald Weisberger, MCCC Faculty Union representative. Okay, I hope I haven't missed anyone. Did we miss? From Senator Pacheco's office. Oh, I'm sorry, Mary. I'm sorry, I apologize. Yeah. Okay, so as I was saying, we're very happy about the governor's proposal, and it's based on a new funding formula that I'll be talking about with you. The funding formula, the impact is really outstanding. Our current state allocation is 13.8 million, okay? With that, we serve 12,200 students each year. The new funding formula, I don't want to get into too many details with you, but we had to hammer this out ever since it started. They went, what would make every community college whole? What do you need and what would it make? Now, we have $20 million from the governor. I must tell you that that figure is up about $58 million, okay? So I don't know if you can write a check today for that or not. But the 50, you know, so that shows you, I think, how underfunded the Commonwealth is, public higher education, and certainly the community college. So at one point, when we looked at what would you, you know, in imaginary world, if you could get everything you're supposed to have, not everything you want, but everything you're supposed to have, our funding should be 20.6% higher, okay? But what the presidents of the community colleges made an agreement that we called it a hold harmless agreement, that no community college would be cut to pay another. No, you can't take from Peter to pay Paul, okay? We didn't want to get the 15 of us fight enough among ourselves that we don't want to increase that fighting. So it was readjusted with the hold harmless level so that we went from 20.6, and this is not what we needed, but this is the first shot with the formula funding. We went to 16.1. So for what's in the currently on your desk, as I understand it, from the governor's proposal, is we go from 13.8 to 16.1. And that is based on 50% for performance measurements, metrics, and 50% for base funding, the sheer size of some of the community colleges, as well as some money that's for smaller schools to, you know, there's enough for them as well, a base funding. So the hold harmless principle, as opposed to stop loss principle. The stop loss meant that some schools would be cut. So you would take from Peter to pay Paul. And there was the stop part of the loss would be that there'd be a floor. You wouldn't lose more than X percent. In this year, what we had drafted was 5%. And that's, you know, that's a considerable cut for some of the schools. So you can imagine some of the meetings that we've had and the discussions. So we move, this $20 million will move us from stop loss, where some school, I think five schools get cut 5%, to hold harmless, where everybody at least, there are those schools stay zero, but the rest of us who have been long suffering move up, okay? So, the direct impact for BCC, as I mentioned, full-time faculty, instructional support, but also something that you're concerned about, and you hear from your constituents, as I do, about fees, okay? And if this money comes forward, I can't make a pledge because that's a decision from the board of our Board of Trustees, but if we get that money, I'm certainly going to be recommending zero, you know, no fee increase at all for our students. And where do we stand in terms of fees? Remember, we've not been funded, and I've told you many times that if you take that 13.8 and divide it by our full-time students, we're last of the 15. We're the bottom of the league. Okay, so we've been able still, despite that, we've been able to hold the line in terms of fees at the colleges. These are the 15, and Bristol is the seventh, number seven on the list at 174. Some are considerably higher, as you can see. So even in these struggles, that's the point I want to make to you, that even in these struggles, for 13 years now that I've been here, and probably before that, we've struggled with trying to keep the place affordable for our students. You know, community college students need help. And with your help, you know, it was a struggle for you to get us that 13.8 million. That wasn't easy. So even in all those years, we've not been outrageous in our fees. And I can tell you personally, not only our office and all of the college officers hold this as one of our highest priorities to remain affordable, but also our trustees. And I wish you could hear some of the torturous discussions and agonizing appraisals that our trustees go through in every year at this time to try to measure how we're doing for what we're going to do next year for fees. And it's you know, it is a terrible discussion to have because we don't want to go $1, let alone anything more than that. And I wish you could see what the great. I can guarantee you that, and I've already heard from the four or five schools that I mentioned that are zero on hold harmless. They didn't get anything, and they've already said they're going to soar on their fee increases to make up the difference. And you know, that's kind of self-defeating for what the governor proposes. You might remember the governor came to Bristol Community College the first year of the ARRA funds when we said, and again, our trustees stepped forward and said, no increase in fees. And the governor and the secretary of education and the commissioner of higher education came down and visited us to see that big announcement that we had. So we're number seven. I wouldn't be happy until we're down the bottom, but. We're certainly not outrageous, and if the governor's process, as I say, if the proposal goes through, we have good things to say. And we also have more student support for us, and that is, there it is, scholarship money. We have, I don't know if you would realize the amount of money that we have available for our students. And a total scholarships of $24 million. And now financial aid people, I have to tell you, financial aid professionals, they have this curious rule that if you take out a loan, where if you don't pay it back, someone will break your legs or something, but if you take out a loan, they consider that financial aid. I mean, I have a mortgage, I don't consider that an aid. But that's in there. That's the way financial aid people work. So I can say that because he's not in our office, but in a room here. But we end up. I don't know if you know the magnitude of the scholarships that we provide, and it's considerable. And it is a great source of relief for our students. And we have a BCC Foundation that worked very hard and diligently for those two priorities, instruction, instructional support, and making it affordable for our students. And we have almost another $150,000 that have been raised through our foundation. And what is the effect of that? And that is the transferability. I wanted to point this slide out to you. I have a couple other slides similar. If a student, Representative Orall's daughter, for example, comes to BCC, she pays $42,286 for the first 2 years, then transfers to UMass Dartmouth, pays $11,213 for a total of for a baccalaureate degree, a total of just under $31,000. Okay? For a student if her daughter went directly to UMass Dartmouth, she would pay $46,000, $46,700. So she saves $15,726 by going to Bristol and then going to UMass Dartmouth. Another thing I want to show you, and it's from the benefit of a beneficiary of legislative action, and I thank you for this. Notice that when her daughter goes to UMass, she pays $11,213. But if you went to UMass as a freshman, you would pay $11,681. So if you transfer, you pay less than a native UMass Dartmouth student. And that's a public higher education system, and it is remarkable, really. It's a wonderful benefit through your action in the legislature. So the savings of $15,726. So, Representative Laurel, you're going to be hearing from our foundation office about the savings. Same with Bridgewater. Same thing with Bridgewater. Same kind of principle, and you save $8,132 by going to BCC and then transferring to Bridgewater. Again, you see the price at year three is at Bridgewater $7,752 compared to $8,052. So you pay less than someone who spent all those years at Bridgewater. Now those are for public higher education. That's the deal for public higher education, but I did want to also, maybe, there. I did also want to show you Wheaton, the local private institution, and the bottom line is $78,900 that you pay. You get your baccalaureate degree from these institutions. It doesn't say with an asterisk or anything like that. This is the degree that you get. So it's a great savings. We're working another priority for the community colleges and the all of public higher education is to put revisit. You've heard a lot about this last spring during all the turmoil about the legislative proposals from the governor. We have a task force on transferability, to ease the obstacles in transferring students. We're going to do we moved away from common course numbering. It seems to be too great an undertaking. But we have a roster called the Mass Transfer category, if you will. It lists all of our courses at the community colleges. They're equivalent at all of the state universities, and they're equivalent at all of the UMass campuses, so that you could easily thumb through and find the course you're looking for, find out where and how it transfers. It's a massive undertaking, as you can imagine, but it's well worth it for our students and well worth the effort. Now, I did want to move a little bit toward our enrollment, another source of pride for the college. In the fall, that's the last available final headcount. We have over 9,000 students that came here in the fall. 9,000 students. That's the way they're broken down by campus. And you have in your packet your city constituencies are broken, I hate that, broken down by sex, broken down by, I don't like to use that phrase, but they are divided by categories for you in your constituent cities, okay? And we'll test you on that later, okay? But I wanted to point out, 9,000 in the fall, another 3,000 or so during the rest of the year. So in a year, we have over 12,000, close to 12,200 students who come to Bristol for credit courses. Now that, despite your image of some other institutions in southeastern Massachusetts, that's the largest undergraduate population for students in southeastern Massachusetts, okay? The largest. We're the third largest of the 15 community colleges, the other two, Bunker Hill and Middlesex, up in the Boston area. So Bristol has grown almost 80% in the 13 years that I've been here to 12,200 each year. I don't think you really know, Joan is always telling me to emphasize this more and more, 12,200 in a year, plus, if you consider non-credit activities, 17,000 more during the year. So I'm not good at math, but if you add 12 and 17, that's close to 30,000 students or people that come through here to avail themselves of what goes on at Bristol Community College. 30,000. And, you know, when you add the number of employees, another 1,000 or so, we are a little city, right? We're a little city. And so I don't know if you know the magnitude that we're trying to serve at 13.8 million, but we're at a campus in New Bedford, campus in Attleboro. We have a location in Taunton, and we're looking to have a campus in Taunton. Representative O'Connell and Senator Pacheco we're working with, as well as the mayor in Taunton. So New Bedford Voc Tech, we have the Duval Street in Fall River. We have other offerings, we need space, and so this has worked out very well. Was that enough emphasis, Joan? 30,000. But not all who come to us, as you know, are college ready. And we have to deal with the issue. Whoa! Oh, I didn't want to do that. Developmental education. There we go. Okay, you gave away my joke. Developmental education. We have an open door. Anybody who comes is welcome. Now you may have differing abilities and differing skills. But we'll make you ready to compete with the rigors of academic life and go on to UMass Dartmouth or Bridgewater or Harvard or Brown, wherever you want to go. But not everyone is ready. We must do this developmental education. It's access to opportunity. That's what we're all about at the community college. And it's a major BCC priority to provide access and opportunity. Now, I must tell you that And we don't get into finger pointing. We want to work together with our colleagues in learning across the Commonwealth. We have, I think it's a fair average to say about half of the students that come require some developmental work. That means developmental work, if you don't know, that means it doesn't carry college credit for transfer, okay? It's something that, think of it as spring training. Okay, you're going to go to spring training, hone your skills, and then opening day, you're ready to begin up on the table to compete equitably with your other students. But almost half come to us, for whatever reason, they come to us unprepared, either in math or in reading and writing. Okay, we give a test, and you've heard about those as well. You can pass MCAS and with no trouble, not squeak by, but no trouble, and then take this test and require developmental work, which is a real disconnect that everybody's attacking at this point. We're trying to solve that issue with preparedness for college and college readiness. But that's where we are. Now, Now, one of the complaints that we hear at for all community colleges is you have too much developmental education, and the complaints are right. If you come to Bristol and you find out, you're expecting to go right into physics and calculus and philosophy, and you find out you're not ready, because we're not going to throw you in the deep end until you're prepared. So you find out you're not ready, you've got to take this, 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 and this before you can even get a credit, college credit course. So it's been called the Bermuda Triangle developmental education around the country. And, you know, I'm sorry to say that it's kind of true. Who has the patience or the money? You get financial aid for those courses, but then your financial aid clock is ticking. And by the time you get to, you may be able to get out of Bristol eventually, but by the time you get to UMass, you know, your financial aid clock has expired. So the developmental education is a very important, we're very proud of what we do at Bristol for developmental education, but it is certainly an issue that we need to work on, is to provide access. Now, you legislators could instantly, when people say, why don't you reduce the developmental education? Well, you could solve it in an instant. Just say, no more developmental education. We're not paying for it at the community colleges. That's what Connecticut did. So what do we do? What does that do to our open door? And we slam the door, pull the window down on the fingers of students that are trying to, not students, people who want to be students, and get a better, aspire to a better life through education. I mean, I don't know what's going to happen in Connecticut. I thought that was ill-advised. As I talked to Connecticut Community College presidents, they were not really consulted in these some of these moves. It's very expensive and it's very controversial, but I want you to know that we're proud. We stand behind it. We've given a great priority to developmental education at this college. And particularly in the last couple of years, we have invested in presidential fellows to explore and research this problem, to put together pilot projects, which we are doing. It calls for computer labs and special techniques and instruction. But we feel it's very important. Half our students are there. By the way, if you aspire to be an engineer or some upper-level science math course, if you take that math exam, 85% don't pass that. If you want to go into that some of those programs, so it's you know, it's a rigorous field. You know, it's not going to be easy. So we're doing what we can. I want you to please call me if you hear rumors about criticisms of developmental education. It's what we stand for. It's a very important part, and it's workforce development. Where are those people? If you slam the door in those people's faces, where are they going to go in this age, day and age, where you need a job for to get it? You need a education, higher education, to get a job. Well, with all the people that I told you were coming here, and all the developmental needs and special needs that we have as programs get more complex and more technologically oriented, we need space. And so I have more good news that we have a technology and learning center building that's making its way through the bureaucracy of the bond bill, but we're not just waiting in queue. We're moving forward, thank goodness. It's not that it's just been approved, and I want to thank you for your support in making sure that Bristol stayed up on that level. So what we have in the line is $46.5 million for a new academic building and for renovations, badly needed renovations, to three other buildings, new modernize our labs, our science labs, our computer labs, and so on. The design process, as I say, we're not just waiting in the queue. I mean, everybody's in the queue at some point, all 29 campuses in public higher education. But our design process has started. And we're looking for occupancy, and I hope you'll be with us as we break ground and then cut the ribbon to move in and occupancy in FY16. So we badly need that space. I don't know, as we struggle to find what to do with our space, this is an outstanding moment for the college. Space is critical issue. So I had a new idea. that we might be able to implement here at the college. And given the fact that things are tight for space in the State House, maybe this would apply. And see what you think about this. So we're going to, I'll recommend this to the Speaker and the Senate President that we may be able to make space. But that's the President's, that's the Cabinet, those are the Cabinet officers of the college, and they're not too crazy about that idea. How about workforce education that we do also to serve those students? Last year's totals are, you know, considering the economy, those are eye-popping numbers because of what's the first thing you do as an employer in tough times? You cut training. And it's been very difficult times, as you know. So we have almost $1 million in revenue that came in last year with over 600 employees. And to date, our Center for Workforce and Community Education is already brought in over 800,000 with 2,900, I call them students employees, as they do the training. So these are private contracts and state grants and Green Center in Duval Street. Non-credit to credit programs, very important. I'm gonna talk a little bit more about non-credit, but it's a pathway. If you can get students into the door, and Vice President Menard and I go to graduations CNA and personal care attendants. And it's a life-changing moment for those students. And some of it is non-credit, but we I know that Joan always emphasizes the idea that they must continue and must continue on. So the pathway is there to move on. Again, what I said about the technological society, you must have some higher education credential in order to move forward. Now, and we also have non-credit adult basic education. This involves adult basic education, GED testing and preparation, and English for speakers of other languages. These are very important pathways to our credit courses and to a job and degree for those people, but they have to start somewhere, like our developmental education students. We had over 1,500 take the course, and we moved forward with over $1.6 million in grants for that. So ABE and a very important part of what we do, non-credit. I always use the word instruction to cover non-credit activity as well as credit activity. It's all part of workforce development. It's all part of this pathway. I'd like you to hear from some of our students, a couple of our students. I'm actually going to start with Ashley Tillman. Ashley is a student now. She has a class that she's got to go to, so we're going to move her up first. Ashley is a member of our basketball team, and you might not know this, but as of the end of the fall semester, Ashley was the national scoring leader in the country. So we want to hear from some of our students, and Ashley, would you come forward? Thank you. Thank you, Ashley.
Thank you. All right, my name is Ashley Tillman. I'm from Fall River, Massachusetts. I'm in the General Studies program here at BCC and working towards being accepted into the nursing program. When I graduated from Diamond Regional Vocational Technical High School in 2009, I had a 10-month-old son and I was 5 months pregnant with my second son. I always wanted to become a nurse, and when I graduated, I wondered if it was still possible. I didn't have much help or money, and I was afraid to apply to a four-year college. Then my mentor suggested I try BCC, so I applied and attended part-time studies for the first year. As I attended, I realized how much I missed going to school. I realized that I might be able to achieve my dream of becoming a nurse. I am now finishing up my first full-time year of studies with a 4.0. Also, my mentor suggested I play basketball for BCC, and I wanted to do this, but then I found out practice was 6 nights a week. I thought this was an obstacle, but it wasn't. Then they allowed me to bring my children to practice with me. This is how BCC is all of a sudden, all my goals seem possible because of the flexibility of BCC staff and its I look forward to achieving my ultimate goal here at BCC, which is getting into the nursing program over the next year. Thank you for listening to my story.
I don't know. Congressman Keating, you think you could hold her down in, on the court, Congressman Keating? You think you could hold her down scoring on the court? No. Well, we have another, not quite a BCC student anymore. He's an alum. Just recently at our Martin Luther King community, Martin Luther King Jr. Community Breakfast, Muhammad was awarded the Distinguished African-American Alumnus Award at the college. And again, another, you think, you know, Ashley has a great story, and I want you to hear Muhammad's story as well. Muhammad Conte. Muhammad.
Greetings all. I gotta put it real high. Does this one need to hear me too? Before I start, I want to take some time to complain. I didn't know I had to wear a suit, so I need to blame it on somebody. I'm gonna blame it on C. All the gentlemen here are wearing suits, and usually I feel good. Today, instead of worrying about what I'm gonna say, I was worrying about how I'm gonna look.
You look,
do I look
right.
Okay?
You look good.
And the second thing I'm gonna complain about, how many of you all, please raise your hand if your name tag was written by hand.
Or if you don't have
one. All right, so that makes you all special like myself. Looking at these figures, I didn't know BCC had to work with so little. They did a lot of great things with little things, with so little. Imagine these numbers, and bigger institutions can't even accomplish what BCC is accomplishing. Sitting there one day telling myself, BCC changed the world by changing life, learner by learner, made sense to me when I heard myself saying, I'm gonna make a dent in the universe. I'm a product of BCC. So all that made sense. Changing the world by changing life, learner by learner. I'm gonna give you a snippet of my story. It might not be as great as Ashley's story, but I want you for a second, picture yourself not speaking English, coming into a country where you don't know anyone and ending up at an institution where you are welcome and you all of a sudden don't miss your family that much. This was me, my case in 2003. I'm standing here today, not only I'm able to speak English, but I started my foundation of the engineering curriculum at BCC. I aspire to do even greater things. So, whatever President Sbrega is asking you to do, no, for real, I'm talking to legislators right now, and by the way, they're not paying me to say this. So I wanna make that clear. Whatever he's asking you to do, greater things, he couldn't imagine, just like I said, doing so much with so little. Imagine what he could do with more. And I'm gonna leave it at that for now, and I have to run to a meeting. I thank you. I do because when BCC called me to show up with or without shoes, I come running. Because this is how grateful I am to BCC. So thank you for listening to me.
You know, Muhammad was very modest. I'm certainly glad he gave BCC a plug. But Muhammad went on in honors work at Northeastern, and he's in engineering, and he is in fact working on a copyright, a patent for work that he's done at Northeastern. Can't tell you about it. I'd have to kill you if I told you what it was. But if that, I told Muhammad, if that patent goes through, he'll be hearing from our foundation office. Thank you. Ashley had to get to class, and Muhammad also is off. But I wanted to also now have you hear from a couple of our union representatives, our heads of our two unions at the college. And the first is our AFSCME steward. You met Melanie Johnson, who is also a steward, but I'd like to ask Altie Hickey to come forward. Newly elected steward in the AFSCME. Come, Altie Hickey.
Thank you. I'm very honored to be here, and on behalf of the members of the AFSCME Union, I thank you for all your help. Members of the AFSCME Union are the unsung heroes. We are responsible for the grounds, the classroom. We also answer your phones after the president recording, thanking you for calling the college. We appreciate all the support you gave us over the years, and we hope you will continue to support us to make Bristol Community College a great learning environment. Thank you.
Thank you, Altie. And also representing our faculty and professional staff, I must say that the president, Professor Diana Yowie, extends her apologies. She had a personal issue that she had to take care of this morning. So what we've asked is our strategic action coordinator from MCCC, Dr. Ronald Weisberger. Dr. Ronald. Thanks,
Ron. He told me to be very brief, you know, as a faculty or staff member, that's difficult to do. You know, we go on, do lectures and all that stuff. But anyway, good morning and thanks for attending this breakfast. On behalf of our local chapter of the Massachusetts Community College Council, which is part of the MTA, we thank you for your support of our college and also colleges throughout the Commonwealth. You know, we represent faculty and professional staff, both full-time and part-time. So, and as the president said, that's along with what Altie represents, that's what makes the college run, including, of course, our administration, who also do the same. So we all work together as a team here. This year, we have a great opportunity, as you heard the president say, to expand the support of the college through the proposal of the governor. And this is really exciting. It's probably, as you know, it's a one chance, I think, to do this. And it may not come around that often. So the increase in the state income tax, which would then allocate additional funds for higher education, and as the president laid out, would really greatly expand our ability in the community college as well as in the universities to serve our students. So this will, among other things, allow us to hire more full-time staff, which we and faculty and staff, which we really need to serve our students as well as we can. In addition, we need additional grant money and scholarship money for our students. And as you know, because of the decrease in funding, tuitions and fees have gone up. Access has been made much more difficult. And that's not something I think any of us want to see. We want to expand. As you see, the college has already expanded over the years. We need to continue to do this. And we don't want the burden of higher education to be placed on the individual institutions or on our students. Because with the kind of student debt that, you know, we don't cost as much as we see as the four-year institutions, but nevertheless, students should not have to graduate with huge debt that really inhibit them throughout their lives, actually. So we are hoping that you will provide the kind of support that the governor is asking you. We, as a union, will do our part to go to the public and work with you to provide that kind of support and to try to and to explain the necessity of raising the income tax and allocating such funds for higher education. So we're going to do our part. We know you will do your part. I think we can all work together and really have a great future for higher education in the Commonwealth. So thank you again for coming, and we'll look forward to working with you.
Well, thank you, Ron. And you hear the passion on behalf of BCC and our students. So we're very proud of that. What I'd like to do off the cuff, I guess it's unannounced, but I'd like to offer tours to you if you wanted a chance. So I also wanted to end up thanking you as well. I'd like to invite, if I could, Congressman Keating, if you wanted to say a few words. It's up to you. I didn't clear it with him ahead of time, but as long as you don't have to guard Ashley, I think it will be okay.
Oh, I know. I'll be fine. This is just a terrific story here, as the two graduates indicated. I'm an alum of the House and the Senate in the legislature. It's great to see current members and former members that I served with here. I think that the story of BCC is a great story. They're the third largest community college. They remain, though, because of efficiency in the lower third in terms of cost, and they're improving on that. One of the things you didn't mention was what you did to try and keep your infrastructure lower by taking advantage of renewable energy, which is going to really cut down and be the provider of 25% of all the energy costs here. I know that last year when I toured here, you were contemplating expanding nursing, and you've done that with the New Bedford nursing or health cohort that's there. I think that the school is one that is reliant, as most schools are, on Pell Grants. And I know with my new colleague, Joe Kennedy, that we're going to have to face what we faced this last term, where they wanted to drastically, and I mean drastically, to the point of almost eliminating Pell Grants for students. Fight that and make sure that that doesn't happen. It went through the House that way. The Senate was able to stop it, but we will continue to fight in that regard. And there was a 33% increase in those school loans that we had to fight against to make sure that's there. I know myself that in my new capacity as the ranking member on foreign affairs for Europe, Eurasia, I talk to business people all the time and try and encourage investment here in this country. There's three things they want. One of them, some stability with our debt. The other one, some stability with tax credits to know what the landscape is. But the third and one of the most important reasons for them to invest in this country and to help our economy move forward and help this Commonwealth move forward is workforce development. In next year alone, the majority of new jobs in this entire country, they're going to require post-secondary education. The community colleges are poised at the intersection of making this a reality. We have to support them. This community college has been doing workforce development and has been aggressive in that. I've seen it. I've gone around and talked to people. You're ahead of the curve, but the curve is a great one, and will help southeastern Massachusetts greatly if we can continue this investment. So it's just not the individual success stories. In the larger sense, your mission is something critical nationally to our economy going forward. And you know, I hope your good work continues. We'll do all we can at the national level to try and make sure those grants are there to give not only equal opportunity, but to propel our economy forward and can allow you to continue your good work. So I know I joined my colleagues at the state level in that mission, and congratulations for all the good things you're doing.
Thank you.
Congressman Keating, thank you very much. We have a great friend in Washington with you and appreciate it. I know you have to leave shortly, so I thank you for all you've done. Also, what I'd like to do, again, unannounced, I guess, is to invite Senator Rodrigues. Senator Rodrick, would you be able to speak on behalf of the legislative delegation? We're running out of time, but it's a full responsibility for you.
Yeah. Well, it's hard to speak for all my colleagues here, but I can tell you that as a delegation, every one of us, individually and collectively, loves Bristol Community College, appreciates what you do, and it is always on the top of our agenda as we meet with legislative leaders to ensure that Bristol Community College gets as much resources as possible to continue its great work. We have a lot of challenges ahead of us. It's funny what a difference a year makes. Last year, Governor Patrick was persona non grata. I think we saw his picture of his face with the red circle because of his proposals for community college reform. This year he proposes $2 billion in new taxes, and you know, he's the hero here. He's a hero here on campus. But you know, it's all a process. And you know, we, and I am entering, I think my 16th state budget deliberation, and whether under my fifth governor, and whether those governors were Republican or Democrat, the process remains the same, that the governor files a budget that is not a practicable document, but it's a political statement. And the governor made some very bold political statements with the filing of this budget. Bold statements relative to tax policy, bold statements relative to housing, public housing policy, bold statements relative to gun control, bold statements relative to post-employee retirement health benefits. And as the governor makes these proposals, it is the responsibility of us to dispose of those and to deliberate those, and we will have a lot of discussions in the forthcoming months of trying to balance all these proposals and ensure that the region that we represent here in southeastern Massachusetts remains a tremendous place to live and to work and to raise a family. And Bristol Community College is at the heart of that. We understand that, and we value everything you do. So as Dr. Weinsberg, I think, so adequately said, we all have to work together. And I'm lucky that I have great colleagues in the state legislature. I have great partners with Congressman Keating, Congressman Kennedy, Senator Warren, and our new Senator Mo Cowan, who we, many of us know, very, 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 very well from working with him in the governor's office, with Jack, President Sbrega, and his team here on campus, that we will all work together to keep moving forward and to ensure that BCC remains the real jewel that it is. So thank you all, and I'm happy once again to be here.
Thank you, Senator. I always appreciate your support and the support of all the legislators. Workforce development is on our minds, what I wanted to point out finally to you, all the things that we do, we have transfer education, as you heard about. We have career technical education where you can move directly into the workforce. We have the developmental education that you heard about, adult basic education, English for speakers of other languages, corporate training. And if you put them all together, what I always say, you put them all together and they spell workforce development. That's what we're about with liberal arts, so you don't have to be in a STEM field, but everything we do to increase education increases our workforce viability in southeastern Mass. Where you have these two terrible, terrible statistics that you all know, levels of literacy and levels of education attainment. And that's why Bristol Community College is here. We're here to help fix that. And I thank you for all your attention. What I'd like to do is ask Chairman Garcia to bring things to a conclusion. And we're glad to stay if you'd like and talk as long as you'd like. And I appreciate Senator Rodrick. I appreciate you speaking. It's an awesome responsibility to try to speak for all of these people and Congressman Keating. Chairman Garcia, thank you again for coming, everyone.
I'll tell you one thing, this is one hell of a way to start the day. You know, with so much success before us, with so many wonderful people, with so much opportunity, but it takes, you know, a partners. You know, we're all partners in a good cause, which is to move this thing forward. Which brings me back to that thing that I originally mentioned about the workforce development. It's key, it's key. It's the way that we can show the rest of the state that, you know, we do exist this side of 495. that we can make a difference. That, you know, it isn't, you know, we're small, but I think it was President Eisenhower that said, it isn't the size of the dog in the fight, it's the size of the fight in the dog. And I'll tell you one thing, we're ready. So, thank you, God bless you. Let's all do it.